Good afternoon. I see that Sharif Kiwan has arrived in the back and has got a whole crowd around him. So it's my pleasure today to welcome you all to this now third day of our conference and celebration of Abounaddara, the anonymous film collective, and their work and its connection to this thematic that we're exploring today, the right to the image. It's been a very, for me, exciting 3 days. It's also been, frankly, a complicated 3 days. And a disturbing 3 days, and a curious and upsetting 3 days, as we've really delved more and more deeply into trying to unpack the experience of what's happening to the people in Syria from all these different lenses that we have used to look into this set of experiences. And also to wonder what are the experiences of the film collective itself, Sharif as its spokesperson, and the others involved, and to try the best we can to hear what they are saying. So as I have each conversation with this project, I ask myself, am I really hearing what they're saying? And how can I better hear what they're saying to us? So as an example, this morning I have opened a couple of events at the New School, one on an organizing group that's come together around what's called the Urban Thinkers Campus. And the Urban Thinkers Campus is a group of individuals from around the world who are working on organizing the UN Habitat 3 conference. And so when I was standing there thinking about the UN Habitat 3 conference, and I was standing in front of this group of, I don't know, a couple hundred people, I said, you know, on Thursday night, we heard a statement read from Abounaddara, this anonymous Syrian film collective. And they said to us, we don't need your honors or conversations. What we need is your action. And so what I said to that group this morning, and what I'll remind us all today, is that the conversation, the dialogue, and the discourse is important, but the action is really what's going to matter in addressing this kind of crisis. As Sharif said, and I'm paraphrasing, so he'll tell me if I got it wrong, he also said, don't ask us what you should do. He said, you do something, and you tell us about it. So it's not, the burden is not on those who are bringing this to our attention to set our course of action, but for us to reflect, to hear, and to figure out what we should do in response to what we're learning today. There's no better place to do that than at the New School, given its long, progressive, and justice-oriented perspective. And so I welcome you all here to this conversation today. I want to thank the Vera List Center and the organizing committee, as well as the those who sat on the prize committee, for having the courage to select this project, Abounaddara, as its 2015 Vera List Prize recipient. And now I'll turn the mic over to Johanna Taylor, who's the co-curator of this particular conference. Johanna.
Thank you, Mary. Mary Watson is the executive dean of the New Schools for Public Engagement and is a great supporter of the Vera List Center and the prize, and we are very grateful to her. Thank you. We are starting this morning with a continuation of our conversations from yesterday with a panel on the ways of organizing in post-democracy. So this panel is taking a detour from yesterday's conversations, which were grounded in Abounaddara's own ways of working, which are also referenced in the weeks of films being shown in the exhibition at Parsons. And today we are looking more closely at different ways that their work is enacted and different things that are a part of that. So with this panel, we are looking at how activists and artists are increasingly adopting new organizing tactics as structures of power shift around them. These new ways of organizing respond to the challenges imposed by shifting post-democratic regimes of power, whether they are anonymous, as in the case of Abounaddara, governmental, or artistic. Speaking on this panel are Emmanuel Castano, who is chair of the psychology department here at the New School for Social Research, Ruth Wilson Gilmore, who is professor of earth and environmental sciences and American studies at the Graduate Center in New York City. Ruth actually was also on our jury for this prize and was instrumental in selecting Abounaddara as recipients of the Vera List Center Prize. So thank you. and moderating this panel is Mackenzie Wark from the New School as well. He is professor of culture and media studies at Eugene Lang College. Before we bring the panel up to the stage, we will again be screening a couple of Abounaddara shorts to set the tone. They are The Lady of Syria, Part 1, and then What Justice?
شايفي في معرض حرمة اطلع بشوف التلفزيون بين ضيعتنا وبين حزيرتنا الرويبة في الرويبة اجا يعني في الاراضي ما اجا تحت قال في غنية قال اختلفنا مين يحب الثاني أكثر واتفقنا أنا أكثر وأنت أكثر شوف الناس عايشة بتختلف بناخذها لكل الشعر طريقة هاي استشوار طبعا انتو بتفكروا انه طريقة التحميم النفسي هاي صعبة كثير كيف بتصير صعبة؟ بتصير صعبة وقت اللي انا ما بنفش بشكل نظامي طبعا نحن حتى لو كنا في حالة حرب بس متابعين الموضة مزبوط صح؟ هلا بناخذ على الطرف الثاني ديري علي ديري على الصبايا ايوه طبعا نحن في هالاحوال صفت عنا المواد في الرداءة هي هلا خلاص هي الشبكة شفتوها هلا اذا مسكتها من هون ما هي رح تنزل ولا خصلة مني تم ماسك مع بعضه
سيديري نحن مسكنا
حدا ما شافوه من هون من هاي الجهة؟ من هاي الجهة؟ أين يا صبايا بكرة أشوف
عطلي
بكرة خميس بكرة عطلي بكرة متخوفين نحن من شغلات كثيرة بجوز تجي طيارة بجوز قذايف بلا بكرة وبعد بكرة أشو؟
جمعة
معطلين لأيمت من تم؟
السبت
الساعة 11 دورة التمريض ضرب الإبر للي يجيني جدل واللي بيعرفني يضربني إبر يجيني 11:30 ماشي؟
Thank you.
لازم يموت. لازم يموت. مو طار شخصي. حقق مع ألف قبلي وراح يحقق مع ألف بعدي. مو طار شخصي. مانو إنسان. مانو إنسان. ولا أنا حيوان، حتى الحيوان أنا بشتغل بالوثائقي من 2000. الحيوان ما بيقتل بهي الطريقة ولا بيعذب بهي الطريقة. حتى الكائنات المفترسة تفترس بطريقة نبيلة، ما بتعذب. هو شيء ما بعرف شو. ما بعرف شو. دشة. هو الدشة. أصلاً حتى لما بتتحقق العدالة أنا ما بعرف منين بدنا نجيب ناس يقدروا يحققوها لهي العدالة. المحقق اللي ضل يضرب بني آدم لمات، شو هالعدالة التافهة اللي بتقول إنه أنت بتشنو؟ العدالة إنك تضل تضربه ليموت، هاي العدالة. بس هي الأزمة عن جد منين بدك تجيب حدا يقدر يضربه ليموت؟ انبسطتي هلا طلعتي الوحشة اللي جواتي؟
Well, my thanks to the Vera List Center for organizing this extraordinary event, which I have to confess, I feel like I'm only starting to catch up with because I was running my own event, which ended yesterday. So my apologies. Our topic is ways of organizing in post-democracy, and I want to leave the last word on what post-democracy might mean to the discussion. I have a few remarks to kind of frame, because we all come from different ways of producing knowledge, and I thought if we start from how we think about the object before us from our own perspectives, and then weave that together, and then introduce the audience into it, we might have a way of approaching this extraordinary work. So I have to start by saying that I do not know much about Syria. I've never been there. I don't speak the language. All I have is a view from afar. There are two things I wonder about, and something I might know a little bit about. And the two things I wonder about are these. Firstly, have the climate wars started? In Syria, as in the Ukraine, the drought has gone on for years, and there's every possibility these droughts are climate related. And the second thing I wonder is whether the resource wars are continuing. To what extent are local conflicts fueled by great power rivalries for control of resource-bearing parts of the world? It's hard to know much about such things when one has to rely on the media for one's information about them, even if one reads the journals with no pictures and 10,000-word stories. We're still talking about media, yeah? I see it all as media. Now, I do know a little bit about the media part, having studied how English language transnational media covers instances of what I call the weird global media event. And here's what I mean by weird global media event. It's an event in that something interrupts the regular cycle of newsworthy situations in that it was not entirely expected. It's a media event in that the coverage of the event is part of the event itself. And it's a global media event in that forces and factors beyond the local ones seem implicated. But it's a weird global media event in that it does not conform to pre-existing narratives for what events are even supposed to happen. So let me give two examples from the past, which happen to be examples that I did study. One was the fall of the Berlin Wall. And this is now part of an accepted narrative about the collapse of the Soviet Union. But we forget that according to the prevailing theory of totalitarianism that was popular at the time, that was not supposed to be able to happen. Mm-hmm. So narratives had to be improvised, and they would be to do with the triumph of democracy and freedom and so forth. But for a while, nobody really knew what was going on or how to narrate it, like how to put the template of the story on top of it. Actors in the event also had to take their cue from a media that could not really help them. Key moments in the logic of unfolding of events happened out of view and so forth. Now, a second example, the occupation of Tiananmen Square in 1987. Gorbachev had come for a state visit and a historic summit with Deng Xiaoping, but students and others had occupied the historic space of the square. And after a lively period of quite free discussion, even in the state media, martial law was imposed. Local media ceased its ability to be open to the event. And so participants had to get their news from foreign news sources, news which was gathered in Beijing, broadcast or published elsewhere, and then rerouted back to Beijing, for example, by a fax machine. Foreign news became implicated in the cycle of events, as were foreign audiences whose knowledge of events in the square was a bargaining chip in the end game for the event itself. Now, both of these weird global media events happened in an era of broadcast and mass print media, before the internet was widely known. Hence, in thinking about them, one has to think a quite specific kind of double landscape, and one has to then think the landscape of that time. And there were particular physical places where these events happened in Eastern Europe and China. But this space also included a mediatic space made of broadcast television footprints, newspaper circulations, and so forth. And linking the two spaces together were certain vectors of reporting, extracting information from the scene, and also of its return via satellite television, the fax machine, and so forth. So the important thing is not to think the physical space as separate from the media space, as if it just represented a physical space. While one has to think both together as the same space, the space of possibility for the event is defined by the disposition of forces in this space that is both physical and mediatic. Now, thinking this double space as one space gets us out of those sort of tiresome arguments about Twitter revolutions and so on that oscillate between ascribing agency only to a media technology or insisting on the contrary that communication has nothing to do with it and agency is only in the hearts and minds of social actors, where you sort of wonder how they even know about each other if you're not dealing with communication, right? Because that doesn't make any sense either. So neither point of view really captures the way that the space of events is always a disposition of forces in spaces that are both physical and mediatic. And this, incidentally, is not necessarily a new idea. It's already the perspective of Clausewitz, who thinks war in these terms. The twin concepts of fog and friction of war apply to the communicative and physical aspects at the same time of inertia, confusion, entropy, and so on. Now, once one grasps the nature of the space in which an event can happen, one can think then about how the strategies appropriate to it have to take into account that double nature of the space of the event. And to give another example, during the Balkan Wars, President Slobodan Milosevic, what was still technically Yugoslavia, faced only one media outlet that was independent and critical of him, a radio station called B92. So naturally, he shut it down. Dutch hackers managed to get a signal out of Belgrade using telephony and the internet, which was then rebroadcast on shortwave back into Yugoslavia by the BBC World Service. So here one can see how some new tactics for conflict and also a rather curious intersection of local activism and great power politics might define the space of this event, and more could be said about that. So all parties to conflicts can be the originating agent of new tactics in these situations. I'm told there was a time when guerrillas in El Salvador took advantage of the fact that the big landowners were defending their property with barbed wire fences by using those fences themselves to transmit radio signals. Students of mine involved in Gezi Park say that there was a moment when they had a tactical advantage over the police because they were using social media tools that their opponents had not at that moment figured out. Another example, when Filipinos wanted to protest against an unpopular president, they took advantage not just of cellular telephony, but of a particular affordance of the technology itself. So when cell phones first came to the Philippines, text messaging was free. The phone technology in use was one that used two separate radio signals, one to carry voice traffic and one to locate the phone's position relative to the transmission cells. So CDA doesn't do that. The other one, I think it's called GSM, it does. So this little detail sort of matters. Because the text messaging service piggybacks on the second of the two signals. So at first it seemed simpler just to offer it for free rather than figure out how to meter it. But of course it became a hugely popular media form in its own right, and you could argue that texting as a media form, you know, the Philippines is where it really kind of starts. So when it came to the unpopular president, texting became a key means of circumventing a largely pro-government media. And the most popular form of protest was the joke, so people are texting jokes to each other using the affordance of the cell phone. Now, it takes a lot more to bring down a president than jokes sent by cell phones, so I'm not offering a monocausal theory, but I'm saying it's part of the space one has to understand within which an event happens or can happen. And one could multiply examples. And in each of these examples, I can't really do justice to the complexity of forces that are involved, and please take these as anecdotes. I'm not an authority on any of these things at all. But I think we need to combine local knowledge about politics and culture with a mapping of the possibility space that is the combined physical and mediatic space within which events can unfold. This gets particularly interesting in the age of internet, cellular telephony, social media platforms. One probably can't take the state or the secret police by surprise anymore where such media are concerned. There probably aren't many states left that are not totally up to date on how to police their own population's media use. But it doesn't mean there aren't tactics that can be deployed and from which one can learn. An example that's a bit like the text message jokes about the president is the example of the use of puns and allusions in Chinese internet culture. It's possible to police the use of certain words or phrases, but at some point it gets a bit hard to black out every last homophone or pun or allusion that can circulate in popular discourse. So one has to think then the space of politics and media together, but also to think politics, media, and the specifics of culture together. The popular cultural resources available to participants in a conflict are also a relevant factor, although not one about which I can say much, given that I don't know anything at all about the cultures of Syria or China or the Philippines. But one of the things about weird global media events is that readings, and more particularly misreadings of culture across borders, is one of the things at work in the event itself. So for example, the statue of the goddess of democracy that was displayed in Tiananmen Square during its occupation was read by American audiences as referring to the Statue of Liberty. And democracy was most likely understood by American audiences as referring to something like our own two-party duopoly. Now, it's highly unlikely that the activists who made the statue or who used democracy as a slogan meant really anything like what American audiences thought it meant. But that's sort of not the point. Like, the misunderstanding is how it works, yeah? Likewise, the resonance with the May 4th movement, which had taken place in more or less the same place, Tiananmen Square in 1919, resonant and relevant to the local participants, is likely lost on a lot of international viewers who are watching these events unfold. But again, in some way, it doesn't matter. The misunderstanding can itself be productive and useful in a weird global media event. So to end with some brief remarks about the video work of Abounaddara, the videos seem particularly interesting to me, the ones that are about everyday life. And I want to talk about The Lady of Syria. And there's actually two parts. There's a second part to that one, which I'll mention briefly as well. So in The Lady of Syria, a woman conducts a lesson in hairstyling during a blackout. And the second part follows up with a video where she talks about her personal views about tradition and identity while sitting in a hair salon with these fantastic pink walls where the paint is worn at some point. I kind of tend to look at the background when I'm looking at these things, so you might have a different read on it. Now, I can only understand what's happening in these videos by reading the subtitles. I don't know anything about the situation of the video. But in a way, it doesn't matter, because as I'm arguing, I think misunderstanding is actually the whole basis of the weird global media event. And so one needs to think about how not knowing what's going on is itself a force with which the actors in the story can play. So it's these moments of the everyday that I find interesting in some of the Abounaddara videos. And I wanted to talk about that subset. There are a lot of different styles of video making, and that is indeed one of the extraordinary kinds of value of this work is looking at different ways that different video makers have approached it. So it's common in situations of struggle to produce counter-propaganda. And in such cases, the opposing or resisting force tries to attack the propaganda of the other side or counter it with a different one keyed to different symbols or narratives. And there are Abounaddara videos that are more like those strategies, which may indeed have their uses, they're just not ones I want to address. So I want to just put those aside. The ones I'm interested in go directly to the space of the everyday, and they seem to me to try to create a bit of a sort of breathing space between the event and the narratives that inevitably come down upon them from without. Because this is the thing about weird global media events. The narrative for the event always precedes it. So you think it's the situation that's generating the story. It's kind of the reverse, is that journalism is a set of stories that come first and then applied to situations as situations arise. And think about weird global media event is that the weird part is the pushing back, is the situations that actually don't lend themselves to effective readings through available narrative strategies. So the narrative for the event precedes it, and the event has to be made to fit. Right, the weird events, they're where they don't quite work. A pertinent example for New Yorkers is 9/11. It took the combined efforts of every reputable talking head in America to talk us through this for weeks before the narrative was back in place. If you watch the, it's on video, I got to get the videotapes transcribed to another format so I can look at this stuff again. But I remember when this happened, I was just tape after tape logging what was on CNN. And you look at it now, it makes no sense. Like no one had any idea what was going on. People say contradictory things. Now it's down to two or three images and a story, yeah? So if you want to study these things or if you're implicated in these things, then start logging the stuff immediately to understand the moment when the narrative doesn't fit. So we're talked through it. Eventually, the weirdness is contained within the narrative, but the narrative kind of comes first, and it's a question of, you know, maybe repurposing different narratives to make them fit the event. The event has to conform to it, except when it doesn't. So for example, we have narratives about good and bad states coded as moderate or extremist. We have narratives about terrorists and freedom. We have narratives about great power rivals, Russia and Iran in the American imaginary. But they don't always fit events very well. But sometimes in Abounaddara videos, watching it here in the context of the United States, one can see this problem pushed into the background in favor of a moment of everyday life. Now, it isn't an innocent moment, although there's something, sometimes an appeal in the video documentary to certain tropes about how the human is constructed in the space of the everyday in video narrative itself. So it's sort of working another sort of terrain of what narrative documentary video can do. Yeah, I don't want to say it's more real. It's not. It's a different set of conventions are being used in the space of these other conventions to do with how events might otherwise be narrated. But I think the real virtue of that is to create breathing space outside the imposition of narrative on the weird global media event. It's a recovery of a space of possibility other than those that those narratives oblige, and in this case, conducted under conditions of extreme duress and difficulty. And this figure of the everyday works particularly well with the anonymous distribution of the videos. By cutting off the signature, the video can appear to come from a people itself. Contemporary media has a sort of dual character, being relatively distributed in a network but vulnerable to the severing of key nodes and to constant surveillance. And the anonymous report from the everyday works its way through those affordances to an audience who becomes part of the space of conflict, whether they know it or not. And as we were reminded in the introduction, it's sort of then up to us to figure out what to do with that. As is probably obvious, I'm from media studies, so this was how I would do this particular thing, and I would not want to suggest that's the only way that one could pass the material that's before us. So I wanted to hand the conversation over to Emanuele and to Ruth to offer some different resources with which we could think it, and then we can have a conversation about it, and gradually we can all join that. So.
All right. Thank you. I'll start here, and then I'm going to go up here in a minute. Well, I'm glad that you mentioned I'm from media studies, and that's my take on it, because I don't think I've ever been in a panel and feeling so different. You know, usually as academic, we sit in panels of peers. I'm a psychologist, and usually I sit without a psychologist. Everybody knows what we're up to. We're going to present data and graphs, and we use the same jargon. and nobody probably could understand us apart from the audience. And today I feel like I have to do a completely different job. But you know, let's see how it goes. Clearly I'm not expert in medias. I'm not expert in art, and not even in images in general. And even the language that is used in this context is somewhat alien to me. And I was, of course, you know, reading, going through the program and listening to some of the discussions of the past few days. And the description of our panel, if I can find it, is right here, was actually mentioned at the beginning. Part of it says these new ways of organizing respond to the challenges imposed by shifting post-democratic regimes of power, whether they're anonymous, governmental, or artistic. And even that is a difficult thing for me. I don't quite understand what it means, frankly. I'm not the only one?
No.
Excellent. This obviously is not about, say something about me and Ruth, more than anything else. So I was a bit of a loss thinking about this panel until I heard the remarks, I think were by made a couple of days ago by Sharif and echoed by Mary this morning and last night as well, who basically freed us from all the anxiety, because they say, we're not going to tell you what this is. You just, you know, react to it. So that's easy. And so that's what I did, right? So what I did is watch these videos and thought, okay, well, what do these videos make me think? Not as an individual, or to some extent as well, but also putting on my hat of political and social psychologist. And that's what I did. And so what do scientists, we claim we're scientists, psychologists as well. Some people may disagree, but once you put on your hat of psychologist, what you do is like, okay, let me go back to my data and see, not my own data exclusively, those of my colleagues in various subfields of psychology, and see what, try to make sense of it. And what are the reactions that we have when we watch this video? So I'm gonna stand up and go back to the podium where there's a presentation that I'm gonna try to, is it here? Thank you. Okay, so we watched two videos, of course, 15 minutes ago, and I went through the first one. I jot down my reactions to it, and I never got to the second one. So I think for the second one, we're going to go spontaneous, right, in the discussion. And so these are the four words. Can you hear me? You don't, right? It's pretty good. Right, pretty good audio. These are four words that came to mind when watching the video. A normalization is a problematic one. I'm much more confident with the three others, but I kept it. Normalization, individuation, humanization, and empathy. And I also tried to oppose it to, so my point here is that by watching this video, these things come to mind. And they're concepts that are very well discussed, investigated, to a large extent through empirical research in psychology and particularly in social and political psychology. Normalization is, of course, you can all, you know, it's pretty straightforward. It means, you know, making things normal. And I think of it in opposition or in juxtaposition to ideas that we often, ideas and images that we often have, I will say in the West. I will, you know, it's as a working definition, right? Countries, oftentimes, unfortunately, of the Arab world in general, and Muslim countries in particular, and particularly of countries that are at war. We think of them, I grew up in Italy in the 1980s, 70s and 80s, with images of the Lebanon war on TV every night. And that, and I thought that that was life in Lebanon, fighting, and fighting 24/7. Also barbarian, and that's a heavy, it's a loaded word, and I'll go back to it in a minute. And the idea of a barbaric society or country in which there is only chaos, nothing else. So when I was thinking about this talk, I said, well, I Google, because that's what we do, right? Life in Syria on Google Images. And this is what comes up. Now, there are some images here that are of images of, life. There is a birthday party somewhere. There is some, images of the market with fruit being sold. But I would say, I don't know, you know, I'm eyeing it at 70% or so of images of violence. So this is what, if you Google today life in Syria, this is what comes up. So to me, that video suggested normalization in the sense that, you know, we saw this woman teaching this group of kids how to become hairdressers, I guess, and also we learned that on Sunday, I believe, they were going to have a nursing class. Also, I found the beautiful images of this woman reaching for a fig, I think, and eating it. And juxtaposed to the image of the explosion, you know, in the next village, right there at sunrise. It was a beautiful image of sunrise at the same time, the explosion. Now, I guess for New Yorkers, the image of reaching for a fig on a tree is just as alien as the bomb exploding. But one, of course, is a celebration of life and normality, and the other one is you know, the images of war. So these are, in a way, important. Also, it's a double-edged sword. Normalization it's a double-edged sword because, on the one hand, it reminds us that these people in this country, in these societies, live just the way, you know, with of course cultural and systemic differences, but just pursuing the same things that we do pursue in our life. And that's good because it changes the images of this. And this is a link to my work in political science and particularly in international relations on images of the other that we have. About in the 1950s, somebody called Kenneth Bolding published a book on images and how these images that we have influence our perception of people in other countries, not only influence lay people, but also policymakers and politicians, and actually impact the decisions that we make, for instance, to intervene in a conflict or not, try to topple a government or not. Among the various images, of course, there is images of the ally, the enemy, and so on. There is the image of the colony, of course, that a lot of Europeans have, or a lot of African countries, and in the US of Central and Latin America, with all the implication that this means. These are, in psychology, we call them cognitive schemas, sometimes stereotypical images, that somewhat captures what we think about that country or those people, and then influence our behavior towards them. And of course, barbarian is one of the images. And these images are constructed by intersecting several factors, some of which is the cultural similarity and sophistication that these people have, and also their relative power. In the case of barbarian, for instance, the image is a strong enemy, but largely disorganized and animal-like behavior. So the images, in a way, convey that we see again and again of these countries, convey this this understanding of who they are. And so I think the video that we just saw somewhat challenges that, reminds us that, you know, there is much more to that than we usually are, you know, seeing on TV or in our videos on YouTube and so on. So that's one first reaction about normalization as opposed to these two others and many others, you know, I guess opposing categories. The second word that comes to mind is individuation. It's a little bit less used. It has a long history in psychology and particularly in social psychology, and it has to do with social perception. And I oppose this word to three others. There can be many, many more, but the process of categorization, the perception of homogeneity, and this unpronounceable world that's probably I've never seen, entitativity, and I'll get to it in a moment to discuss what it is. Individuation is when we encounter another human being, how do we perceive them? Do we attend to them as unique individual, as human, or do we immediately categorize them in one of the many social categories that we have available? Now, a lot of research, decades of research in social psychology tell us our spontaneous, immediate first impression is category-based. It's heavily dependent on context. If I'm in an academic context, I show up in class, I see students, I don't see human beings, and they see a professor, an academic. They don't see me as a human, Emanuele, as a person. And depending on how much motivation we have and the possible other effect of the context, we come to see them ultimately as human beings. Sometimes we never do. And of course, you know, this process of categorization leads to stereotyping, and oftentimes, of course, prejudicial activism, because stereotyping is oftentimes has a negative valence, unless we're stereotyping ourselves. And even when it has a positive valence, it is disturbing to us. I'll give you an example. As I'm Italian, I've been here for 12 years. It does bother me when people in a variety of contexts attend to me and draw conclusions about me because of my Italianness. And the stereotype that I'm the target of is pretty positive. In New York today, I would say, you know, Italians are considered fashionable, as you can see. He can probably cook a good meal for us, right? Those are two good things. I don't know, there's no negative stereotype as is dangerous as a lot of minority stereotype in these countries, or uneducated, or unpredictable, right? And yet, when we are perceived as such, it is disturbing, even when it is a positive image. Why? Because we don't like to be perceived as a member of a category. We like to be attended to and considered as for who we are, right, largely. Now, together with this process of categorization and stereotyping comes an homogenization. So that's why we say, you know, they all look alike, right? And we don't really, we perceive others, members of these groups, as interchangeable. And we don't really attend to their humanity. I will come back to the concept of humanity in a minute. And finally, there is entitativity, this word that we use in social psychology to refer to the extent to which a group is perceived as having a real entity, as being agentic. But oftentimes, when it comes to others, is the perception of them as a monolithic entity. I'll give you a few examples. And this is the image that we often have. You know, when we depict Muslim countries or Islamic countries, this is the image that is often depicted. It's an image that is, there is research on this, is perceived as threatening to us just because it impacts and elicits some psychological understanding of a monolithic entity that is different from us, is other. And these images, research shows, do in fact elicit a sense of threat. Now, how do we undermine this? How do we undermine the perception of others as a monolithic entity and homogeneous? Well, we've done a lot of research on this, and this is my favorite one. It's not conducted by me. This is by some of you. There's a lot of people who can speak French here, of course, and can probably read this. This is a piece of a poster produced by two colleagues of mine in France, Marcus Breyer and El Rafid, respectively a German and Egyptian researcher, who in their research tried to undermine this monolithic entity of monolithic perception of Arabs in France. As you know, in France, as in many other European countries, there are negative stereotypes about Arabs that are, you know, lead to prejudice and discrimination in a variety of contexts. And their point is, what we have to do is to undermine this monolithic perception, this homogeneous perception, by individualizing them. And that's, you know, that's why this word was important for me when I watched these videos, because I think this what the video, these videos, part of what they do is to individualize others. They make us aware of their life, their daily life. There's humor, you know, there is this tendency of discussing fashion and style, which is relates to you know, this dimension of humanity's vanity. And so this research in a way suggests, yes, this works. When we individualize others, we manage to reduce stereotypic perception and prejudice. This is a post that was shown, was displayed in a school through an experiment in France for several weeks. And then over time, measures of prejudice against Arabs were taken with the students in the school. And what was found is that after a few weeks of exposure to this poster, that was simply posted around the university and high school buildings, when people were asked to judge and tell what they thought about Arabs, the image was more positive. It was much more heterogeneous. And so that worked. And is one of the few examples in which we can claim, oh, psychological insights, research findings from psychology can be applied. That's why I used this example, right? So it was, you know, it's a success there. As you can see, right, they say it's Jasmine is optimist, or prédécesseur, I think, is stingy, right? Meaning, literally means close to her money. That's Aisha. Or Saeed, who is an excellent foreman, I think that's how I would translate it. The idea here is that to present individuals from this group that we tend to perceive as, you know, they all look alike, as single individuals with their preferences, with their positive and negative traits, as we are, as complex human beings. Third word, humanization, and that's really where I had to talk about this, because this is where my expertise lie primarily. Of course, I think it's easy to see how the video humanizes members of this group that we don't know anything about. It's not only Ken who does has not been to Syria and doesn't know anything about the country. I have not either. So our images of Syrians is based on, you know, and our understanding of who they are on a few images that we see and a few articles that we read here and there. Certainly not often a humanized image. So these videos are representing their life, their daily life, humanize them. And of course, the word is to be opposed to the opposite process that we know are highly detrimental to the way we treat others, the humanization. I want to write evilization, but it seemed a little bit too much, so I stuck with the evil. Evil perception of them as animal or emotionless robots. Here we have conducted a lot of research, and when I say we as social psychologists in general, but my research group as well, showing how the process of dehumanization is a precursor to violence and how perceiving others as lacking humanity in a variety of ways facilitates the mistreatment of them. I'll present briefly results from these three studies coming out from published work in the past of myself and my colleagues. The first one is some work from a Palestinian sample. Sorry, here we go. In which we ask a group of Palestinians, we also did a study with the Israeli counterpart, the extent to which they perceive Israeli Jews as possessing sentience. In other words, this is a fancy word for the capacity to experience emotions and compassion for others, right? Which is considered one of the primary characteristics of humanity. What it means to be human, when you ask people to this question, of course, language intelligence comes out, but one of the first things they say is this capacity for experiencing empathy, compassion, and sophisticated emotions, right? And so after we asked them a lot of questions that can be kind of summarized in these boxes, and of course what we were interested in finally was to what extent people would support bombing campaigns, bombing attacks, or peace deals, right? The first two being, of course, two negative interactions, and the first one, of course, is a positive one. And as you can see, that the more sentience, the less desire for retributive justice, and the more retributive justice, the more bombing campaigns and the more bombing attacks and the less willingness to engage in peace deals. So the more you dehumanize, you perceive Israeli as lacking humanity, all these negative things happen. The very opposite, of course, for restorative justice. Restorative justice, of course, these are questions about how you go about reestablishing positive relation with them. And it has a positive effect. As you can see, the green arrows are suggest positive relationship. And of course, you know, most importantly, more support for peace deal and less support for bombing attacks and bombing campaigns. In America, it's not just Palestinians. And we conduct a lot of studies in the United States with American participants in the context of the Abu Ghraib situation, in which, of course, you know, American soldiers and CIA officers and others ended up torturing and, of course, in many cases, killing prisoners, right, in Iraq. And elsewhere. And we measure several things here. Some of these things are pretty self-explanatory. The one on the left, glorification, is a new variable that I'm introducing. I'll tell you, it doesn't take much to understand what it means. It's simply the tendency to glorify one's country. That is, unfortunately, is very well pronounced in the United States and in many Western countries. And so what we find here is that the more people have this tendency to perceive that we are the greatest country in the world, the more when I'm presented with these scenarios, when I'm reading articles about, you know, situation like the Abu Ghraib one, where my people, of course, these are not soldiers responding participating to our experiments. They are lay people, right, to whom we present these articles. Sometimes we create the articles ourselves, but pretty much are, you know, similar to what you could read, you know, during those years in the United States about the events that were happening at these prisons. And then we asked them to what extent they perceive that the victims of this torture and the family members of the people being tortured and killed would suffer emotionally, and to what extent they perceive Iraq as a whole, as a group, human or somewhat less than human. I'm not going to bother with the specific questions. I'll hope you can ask me later, and I'll try to give you a big picture here. So the more people glorify the United States, the more we, I'm not even American actually, but I know the more an American glorifies the United States, the more they react to that situation, to witnessing, to seeing this picture, because we present in pictures as well, and reading about these events by emotionally minimizing the suffering of the others, by perceiving them as less than human. And this in turn led to lesser requests for justice in the forms of, you know, the interrogators and the torturers should be held accountable. You know, the leaders that were running these prisons and organizing this should be held accountable. The victims and their families should be somewhat taken care and reparations be provided to them. Right. So all of this was lesser as a consequence of perceiving them as less than human. And of course, that's minimizing their emotional suffering. It also goes the other way around, in the sense that a few years ago now, almost 10 years ago now, I just realized, 9 years ago, we published this, these findings with series with many studies in which we asked people to consider, these were American participants, think about, and we presented with scenarios about what happened to Native Americans when the first settlers arrived, and in the, you know, in the immediate years following that. And we asked them, we either presented with a condition where we told them very little about what happened, that's what we call a control condition, and to the other half, we told them, we remind them of the massacres that ensued and the treatment of Native Americans. Subsequently, we asked them to what extent they thought that Native Americans are capable of experiencing different traits, different emotional states, and so on, that we can classify as low inhumanity or high inhumanity, right? And you can see in the control condition, and here Americans are white Caucasian Americans, right, the participants, they say, well, you know, they're pretty much capable to the same extent, the two bars on the left, to experience this emotion regardless of these traits, regardless of whether they're high or low inhumanity. So there is no difference. They look a little bit different, these two means, but they're not. Now, the picture is completely different once you tell them that they, so to speak, their ancestors, to which they are linked by virtue of their ethnic collective identity, they massacred them. So when you remind them of them, what happens is that they really deny them these very traits that define them as humans. All right, so this is, I hope you could follow the graphs. We can go back with another hour here to discuss it, and then I'm going to pretty much conclude on this. The last word that came to mind, of course, by looking at these videos is empathy, which is, of course, related to humanization. It's only when we perceive the others as humans, to some extent, we obviously sometimes empathize with animals as well, but our degree of empathic reaction to the suffering of humans is much higher. And, of course, the opposite of this is disregard. And two of the phenomena that I already described, the individuation and dehumanization. Right? And I think that these videos, by reminding them of the humanity, of their idiosyncratic characteristics, of their individuality, really foster empathy towards them. And of course, as we know, empathy is one of the great mediators, one of the great mediating factors of including others in our, what we call this, you know, the scope of justice, the moral community to which we belong, and therefore ensuring protection, aid, helping behavior, and so on. I'll stop here. Thank you.
Well, I don't have a presentation, so I guess I'll sit. That's all right? I usually like to stand, but today I'm a little under the weather. I apologize. I particularly apologize to my friends and colleagues here at the New School for having missed a good deal of the conference because of my kind of fragile health, and especially to my brother from Abounaddara, who came to speak on behalf of the collective and to speak from a place that is so intensely under attack, and as he said to us the other night, a society being destroyed, society, which I think is an important word. I want to, I don't have a written script to read to you. I have a little bit I'm going to read, and the rest is notes. I'm not sure I have an argument to make, and I think it doesn't matter, because I really didn't understand exactly what it was that we were going to do today. I just thought it was great we were going to come together and try to figure it out. As I was listening to Ken talk about the various ways that people use media that can travel longer distances than they can themselves and get under a radar as well as be grabbed in the radar, I thought about the kinds of organizing that people have done in the United States in a good deal of the latter part of the 20th century, in the United States and abroad, using, for example, low-frequency radios. So there's a fantastic book called Radio Free Dixie that, surname Tyson wrote, in which there's a wonderful description of an organizer putting together a rent strike in a public housing project here in the United States. Those are very difficult things to organize because the projects are so intensely policed and people are always threatened with eviction if they get out of line. And so the way people got to know about meetings and received updates and so forth was to turn to the low frequency on their radios, and the organizers would ride around on bikes with a transmitter on the back of the bike broadcasting. And they would be on the move so nobody could catch them. The same technique was used in Haiti to organize people for the first election of Aristide as president of Haiti. Again, they took these low-frequency radios that any one of us could make. Anyone in this room could make one of these things. And they're very, very cheap and easy to do. But they took these radios out of the urban areas and out into the bush, and that's how they organized people, managed to reach people collectively and get people to do things that otherwise they might not have thought to do, which is to say that's how they created some power. That's how they created some power. And creating power is what, in my view, organizing is about. Insofar as, again, to take up the themes that Ken gave us, insofar as we were talking about space that has a dual character to it, we're also talking about what we make of space. And what we learn, I learn, and through feeling, through empathy and so forth, watching the films that Abounaddara has produced for us every Friday for some years now, is a sense of place, right? A sense of space fully inhabited by people who have a sense of themselves both there, whether rooted or not, but there in such a way that I feel, I'm not sure I can fully express this, I feel that they would like to continue to be rooted there or somewhere like there, right? So place-making practices come through in these tiny and beautiful and devastating films. It is, in my view, always and forever, for my entire life, I'm 65 years old, a strange notion that firsthand experience should matter in how we think about people on this planet. I just find that an astonishing assumption, given that there are now, about 7 billion of us, and the idea that we would have inter-ethnic firsthand experience of each other is an absurdity. And yet, we do work from that assumption that somehow a firsthand experience ought to be made available to those whom we are trying to hail to our cause, and therefore people try to organize to produce the effect of firsthandedness, even if it's not firsthanded in fact. Certainly, I'm thinking about the last slide, Emanuele, that you showed, or your last discussion about, second to last, rather, about humanization and dehumanization, and thinking about the first settlers here in the United States. And you said, and I'm saying this in a very friendly way, first settlers in immediate years thereafter. This is 1619 until the 20th century. The immediate years went on and on and on and on. And so part of the refusal on the part of people to acknowledge that human beings were chased and murdered and chased and murdered and chased and murdered and chased and murdered and chased and murdered across this continent has to do with its persistence, not its ancientness, and its the effects of that persistence today. And in saying all of that, I find that at the moment, I am more troubled than confident that visual, or making visible, making seeable, certain kinds of experiences is a way toward building political solidarity and political struggle. I feel the skepticism, mostly for the following reason. I'm going to read to you very briefly. And this is from a project that three of my colleagues and I have started on in the last year or so. And it's called Seeing, the Problem. What do we see when we think we see? Some of the colleagues I'm working with on this are Françoise Vergès, Avery Gordon, and Cedric Robinson. So a few years ago, so this is 2011, the circulation of images from North Africa and West Asia convinced many people that ongoing regional and national crises had finally blossomed into revolutions, and that the slick and quick ability to share pictures and accompanying verbal narratives played a causal role in political mobilization. I don't think anyone here would disagree with that assessment. Since then, however, changing political conditions, both in West Asia and North Africa and elsewhere, have prompted critical analysis and careful reflection. But I think there is still a lot more to be said, and what the four of us are curious about is the power and problem of the visual in the age of its mechanical reproducibility and rapid diffusion. So we are in particular provoked by the transnationally circulated pictures of people killed and being killed in the United States, in East Africa, in West Asia, and beyond. So this is, I think, the exact same concern that my brother Kiron has brought to our attention, and that what Abounaddara is doing is refusing to reproduce those images. And yet, there's a way here in the United States and elsewhere that in a lot of the dominant counter discourse, if you'll allow that, people do think that showing Eric Garner dying again is going to produce an outcome that would prevent another Eric Garner from dying. And we know it's not true. Like, we know this. This is a fact. This is empirical. I'm a social scientist. I actually do believe in facts. And we know that as of this morning, police in the United States of America have killed 929 people. As of this last time I looked, 929. That's what? More than three a day? About three a day? Every 8 hours? All in a day's work. So seeing Eric Garner die over and over again, experiencing the visualizations of Michael Brown lying in the street over and over again, looking at Walter Scott run through the park and be shot in the back and then set up over and over again, and so forth, has raised a certain kind of critical speech to the top of many newspaper front pages and social media front pages, but it hasn't stopped the practice. It hasn't stopped the practice. And indeed, if we look here in the United States at what the most powerful people in the Federal Justice Department, for example, and in the White House and in the Congress, and decision makers who circulate between and among large foundations and large and very powerful NGOs or not-for-profits are doing, is calling for some better way to punish the police who kill people, which doesn't stop killing, right? It doesn't stop killing. It's just a way to talk about punishment. So given this problem, as we understand it, I'm left with being perplexed about what we should do. What work does this seeing and sharing do? If visuals seem to speak for themselves, what do they say? So if they say, for example, the lady from Syria is human, this is a great thing to say. And the feeling that I get watching that video, I've watched it 4 times, the feeling always overwhelms me. It is a very powerful thing. I already knew she was human before I ever laid eyes on her. So I'm not really sure what to make of the fact that I get a lot of feeling from looking at something which I had already reached the conclusion that's been suggested to me I will get to if I watch the video. So that leaves open a problem for political consciousness and organization. Again, if visuals seem to speak for themselves, what do they say? Can we identify, and this is something that both Ken and Emanuele have done in their comments today, can we identify how these images are both discursive fields of representation and situated in broader such fields? And what contradictory structures of feeling shape the reception and use of such images? In short, do you already have to be open to be open? And if so, then what kind of organizing might be necessary? It changes what some hope will be spontaneous attraction to justice into something else, right? There, in short, I actually don't believe, I'm quite pessimistic. I'm optimistic and yet pessimistic. I've been called by some a bitter optimist. So I think that this spontaneous attraction, when it happens, is usually short-lived. It doesn't matter enough. And I'd love to be convinced by my expert friends in media, and especially my expert friends in social psychology, that I'm wrong. But if the spontaneous isn't enough, then what happens in that moment, in the space of the spontaneous, that people can bring to some kind of regular and reproducible form? I mean, political parties, and I don't mean Democrats and Republicans, might be one of the answers. Some kind of institutionalization of that attraction, which then produces its own contradictions that we could talk about a lot. What do these stark depictions obscure? Where should we focus to tease out the dialectics of visibility and invisibility? And how might the rhetorical and political effect presume to consolidate movement against the imperial depredations of racial capitalism on a world scale actually recapitulate the fragmenting force of organized abandonment and organized violence at all scales? And that is what concerns me most. There's an extent to which I think this spontaneous attraction to social justice is very fatalistic, that it is attracted to a kind of hopelessness, and I think a sort of existential nihilism is very much in play these days in many places around the world. None of what I'm saying is to criticize what Abounaddara has done, but rather to ask us here in the United States, among elites, what it is we ought to do. We were told the other night that it's not our responsibility to effect regime change in Syria. That is the responsibility of the Syrian revolutionaries. It is our responsibility to be attentive to the question of the image. Now, contrary to what we heard the other night, it's actually not the case that images of bloodied and murdered bodies of people of US citizenship are not shown on media all the time. They really are, but but it's certain people, and this goes back to what Emanuele was talking about. Certain people are expected to die soon. Certain people are expected to die horribly. Indeed, racism is group-differentiated vulnerability to premature death. That's what it is. It's how it works. And that undifferentiated difference that Emanuele was talking about shapes who counts in the representability of horror and terror and violence, you know, how they should be represented. So I have a question for all of us. Can we take a material inspiration from the work of Abounaddara, and in lifting the challenge to us that Abounaddara gives us, use that also in these other instances, right? In these other instances. I mean, if you listen to the big three of Black Lives Matters, Alicia Garza, Patrice Marie Cullors, who I've known since she was in high school, and Opel Tomati, they say over and over again, our job, our practice, our organization, if there is an organization beyond the hashtag Black Lives Matter, is to, and I quote, rehumanize Black people. Rehumanize Black people. And I think that's a great thing to do. And then I get really, 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 really frightened, because it's already acknowledging the not human that turns into animal as the starting condition from which all kinds of people over a long history of philosophical and social thought have been railing and railing and railing and railing. So Sylvia Winter, or W.E.B. Du Bois, or Frederick Douglass, or Harriet Tubman. I mean, we have all these people who have done things to make impossible that in the year 2015, anybody of African descent, known African descent, because we're all of African descent, right? But that social category today could stand up at a microphone and say, my job is to rehumanize people. All right. So the last thing I want to say is something about the conversation on Thursday that Karen and Ken had with Sharif. And the peculiarity of that conversation, were people there? I mean, who were not in the conversation? Okay, it was a very strange, strange, strange conversation. It was actually three separate events organized around a coffee table with people looking at each other and then speaking these three complete sets of ideas and concerns and insistences. And I think that we here at the New School, and we here in New York, and we here in the world must take seriously the impossibility of that conversation and try to figure out, as I think we can do through struggle, try to figure out how that impossibility might not be reproduced, right? Might not, it will be reproduced, but how might it not be reproduced? Amiri Baraka taught us in one of his many fantastic aphorisms, that which cannot be explained is expressed through art. And I actually think that art is not the answer because it's so exalted. It's the answer because the sort of magic that happens when somebody, Abounaddara, does something to something and then does something else to it, gives us a small and perhaps unreliable opening to stop the reproduction of the kind of not conversation that my colleagues had the other night. At the end of the day, I think what we're trying to figure out here is how to make, you know, beautifully crafted, detailed, amazing, lovely plowshares into swords. And if we want to make plowshares into swords, what kind of fight are we in the midst of waging. In my view, we're waging a fight against racial capitalism on a world scale. And it is an absurdity to me for us not to take that seriously, however else we understand the particular spatializations of that struggle as it plays out in time and space. The narratives that we are able to pursue are the narratives that, when I say we, I mean we as a collectivity, not we as Americans, but we as people fighting for justice. The narratives that we are able to pursue are dependent on making abundantly clear what structures of feeling, what ideas of change, right, what possibilities of change are available to us as we go into the future that is frightening but inevitable, unless we die, to encounter. And those narratives, those structures of feeling, in my view, rest on, as it were, infrastructures of feeling. And those infrastructures are varied, and they've developed among people who have fought for liberation in a variety of contexts over time, but they have as their commonality a sense that there is always a possibility to move toward justice that is an opening, that is participatory, and at the end of the day doesn't depend on harming, much less slaughtering, anybody else. Such an infrastructure of feeling that guides my own work is the Black radical tradition. So I mentioned Du Bois, I mentioned Sylvia Winter, there are many other people. It's not the only one, but it is one. And if a tradition is, as Raymond Williams argued, the selection and reselection of ancestors, the accumulation of structures of feeling over time, it means that many of the false divisions that we live as though they were necessary and inevitable, such as biological kin and so forth, are overcomable when we understand how we make our ancestry as well as live the consequences of who's produced us. That's it. So now are we supposed to debate?
Well, where do we go from there? Yeah.
Again, we didn't get a hug. That's a failure.
You'll get one later.
Okay, thank you.
I wanted to not leave unremarked the second video we saw, which was the What Justice? And I can't do it justice, but after listening to Manuela, I was thinking of the power of the speaker in that video, who does, in fact, dehumanize the torturers. You could interpret what he does is that. But then dehumanize a possible category of justice that might respond to it, but in a slightly different way in terms of its impossibility. And then lastly, to dehumanize himself or to acknowledge his own complicity and the act of that. And it just strikes me as very, very powerful now, reading it back through the categories that Emanuele gave us. And then I was also trying to read what Ruth and Emanuele were saying together to think about, I mean, a very different kind of video or image in terms of their provenance, but things like the cell phone footage of Eric Garner or what are most likely police or journalism-generated images of other people of color who have been killed. And the way they circulate, but then the way they might oscillate between empathy, but also normalization, that, oh, that just happens over there. I think this is the ambiguity you were getting at, mm-hmm. and your sort of lack of satisfaction with what that generates. And so what I wanted to ask the two of you, if you could reflect on this a little bit, is how you get from the affect of the particular mediated instance to a concept of how it's thinkable beyond its immediate set of categories that one intuitively understands it through, to institutional form, structure feeling, selective tradition, which might be a language we would speak, but maybe is not the language Emanuele would speak, but yeah, what do you build? Yeah, yeah. What do you build out from that so that one isn't caught in loops or cycles of reacting to images through pre-established categories? And you had a nice example in terms of the posters that were shown in the school, so proof of concept. But I'm just wondering, what that then leads colleagues in your field to think about things you can build.
Please, Ruth.
Well, I just did all my talking.
Again, I'm not sure. I understand you can, but I'll try. First, let me go back to the video that I think we didn't quite celebrate it to some extent as the first one. Not because it's less powerful, I think it's remarkable. And one thing that touched me about that video that also relates to some other work I'm doing some in my lab is how it was shot, right? Because I think, let's think for a minute how different would have been to hear the statements from this man which would basically, I think if we put them all together, probably would have lasted 30 seconds, right? Hmm. How different it was. Obviously, it was deliberate, I guess, right, from the filmmakers. Because what is powerful there is that we are thinking with them. We're like, they're all disposed. We're looking at him. And what he's conveying is that this person is being very thoughtful. He's really thinking hard about, obviously, I guess it was a victim of interrogation and possibly torture, and he's thinking about this torturer, who I guess has been captured or is in jail, and is being asked, should we kill this person or not? So of course, as you mentioned, there is the link to the humanity and to the humanization of that person. And it's interesting because it's basically, it's not even an animal, because an animal would not do these things. Mm. You have to be a monster, an ugly monster, right, to some extent to do these things. So, but for me, it was very interesting to see the video, and I watched it several times as well, and really think, wow, it really, and that's something I'm not used to, as I mentioned before. I watch videos as we all do, but not from a professional standpoint. And how powerful that is to watch a person thinking before emitting a judgment, because you can imagine a person who has gone through that, victim of this, humiliating and all that suffering, to really thought about it, to think about it, as opposed to just lay it out, right? And I think it makes a very important difference in how we think of ourselves. So that's my reaction to the video. And of course, as you mentioned, it relates to this big topic of dehumanization. And it's, as you were saying as well, ultimately, this is what it is all about. Are we excluding people from this circle of, some scholars call it the moral community to which we belong. We have different names for it, but ultimately it's always the same thing. Do we draw boundaries between humans? And of course, when these boundaries overlap with power relationships, the consequence can be very important and detrimental. What do we do about this? And once we learn all about this, social psychology is extremely good at showing us how bad we are. Right. We make careers out of this for decades. We're really good at this. There is a whole line of research for the last 20 years just to relate to the situation in the United States you were referring to. It is paradigm, the shooter bias. You may have heard of it, right? That we document how we tend to shoot in simulated situation an African American, even though he does not have a gun in his hand, right? It's kind of reproducing in the lab the phenomena we witness on a regular basis. So, but what do we do about it? Now, there is work being done. There is social psychologists working with the police, trying to see whether this bias can be undermined, although it seems like, it's an uphill battle, because it's continuously reinforced. That's the problem that we have. It's not something that it happened at some point. Thank you for pointing out, my My remark about the Native Americans was not that it happened then and then it stopped, was that in our experiments we reminded them of that particular time. Mm. So, but you know, taken, well taken. It's not something that is behind us. It's something that is continuously reproduced, right? So for sure. You know, the poster, I thought that's why I showed it, because it's actually, unfortunately, one of the few examples where researchers, of maybe 20 years of research on the phenomenon of homogenization and intersectivity and so on, led us to produce a tool for change, right? That seems to be effective, you know? I lament the lack of products that come out of research, you know, oftentimes, particularly when the questions that we're approaching are so important, and so, you know, and the lack of solution is so consequential. And, you know, we have a few examples, but I think, you know, we're, you know, in academia, we're often guilty of having a kind of an umbralistic view of things and keep reifying and documenting phenomena, but, you know, and then we ask by activists, like, so what, right?
And the other thing I wanted to mention was something that didn't come up, because I cut it out and it didn't come up elsewhere, although it is, in some ways, there's work in this body of work that answers it. And it's the tendency for the moment of empathy with the other to suddenly crystallize around the figure of the dead, injured, or suffering child, but where the response is always then limited to something that's humanitarian. And so we cannot then reinscribe something that's happening in terms of war or politics, let alone a geopolitics. And we've just seen this happen in the figure of the child who now has a name, which I'm sorry I've forgotten, who washes up on the shore, who is a, call it what you want, a refugee, a migrant. And suddenly there's the switch from that's the bad other to that's one of us. But then there's a whole set of questions that then can't be asked at all. So to what extent is there even, while one might want that first gesture, to then be somewhat skeptical about it stopping at that point? Mm-hmm. That even if one gets rehumanization, you don't get people reinscribed in politics of inequality and violence. Mm-hmm. You stop at a formal sense of, you know, it's all us. Mm-hmm.
That's a huge problem in the United States today, for sure, and it extends around the globe, at least from the point of view of, what we call Western media and beyond. And that is the rapid way that people embrace this concept I call relative innocence, that people who are indifferent to or just sort of shocked into inaction by certain kinds of, you know, large-scale harms and atrocities, whether it's what's happening in Syria, mass criminalization and incarceration in the United States, the fact that 49 million people in this country go to bed hungry every single night, that's one in six, whatever these things are, the way that people, and this goes back to the problem of the narrative, you know, come to be sentient about this problem and imagine it could be partially solved is by identifying who the relatively innocent victim of this is. So children, in almost all cases, count as the relatively innocent, including that very sad picture that you referred to. In the case of mass criminalization, the relatively innocent include, and are not limited to, women who are mothers, people who are gender nonconforming, youth. And what happens is, and then always the nonviolent. And I'm putting that in scare quotes in case, you know, the transcript doesn't reflect that I put my fingers up and went nonviolent. Mm-hmm. The definition of violence is a very, very broad thing. Mm-hmm. And how it's defined under criminal law in the United States of America would take your breath away. Take it away. But we're not here to discuss that. We are here to discuss, so what about the relative innocent, or that category relative innocence, and how much does that sort of set into motion certain kinds of feelings, empathetic feelings that then move toward some kind of action that, however laudable, reinforces the problem the action was originally sort of hailed to deal with. And that's why What Justice, it's called, right? What Justice is so particularly powerful for me, because not only because we think with him, but we think with him through his revelation of himself, as it were, as one of the relative innocents. I too suffered. He tortured me, but he tortured all these people. And then he said, but this is what I think. And then at the end, now are you glad you found the monster in me? Hmm. So he's refusing, in my view, a category that has to be refused, and that is the category of the relative innocent, towards some form of justice that gets past the idea, eye for eye, tooth for tooth, retribution, and there are many other forms of justice that people practice on relatively small scales, but they do it successfully daily, in which they figure out ways not to punish perpetrators of domestic and sexual violence better, but to intervene so those kinds of events don't happen, right? People who try to figure out how to create in their communities ways for mutual support, so that even in the midst of horror, there is life to be lived. And that's what I see, again, in the Abounaddara films. Not so much I think Ken was saying the other night, ordinary life. I have got nothing against ordinary. I write a lot about ordinary people. But rather, the extraordinary ways that people produce what I like to call an abolition geography, even in the midst of the impossibility of abolition, mm-hmm. right? They make it. They make it, whether they're making it in the cellar with the beauty parlor lessons, or they make it even in the brother in What Justice trying to figure out what justice might be.
And being from media studies, I also got to point out that it's a medium wide shot with a slightly strange angle, so you see empty chairs in the background. And whether you're conscious of it or not, I think the space of the other is in the shot. And also he has to walk through that space to get out of it at the end. So you could kind of, so I apologize. I would like look at the form of how it's done and completely not even see, you know, what the person is saying. But it's a question of being trained to perceive different things in the object of study. All right, now, do we have any thoughts from the audience at this point? Are there things people would want to bring to this question? Yes. If you could, there's a mic coming for you. Thank you.
Hi. I have a question about Emmanuel's presentation, in particular the terms you use. Like, I was thinking of the term individuation, and what does it mean to use that term in the service of an abstraction? So with the image of the faces that you showed and the names, it's still in the service of a category which we can describe as somewhat abstract, whether Arab or Muslim. And also, to me, it struck me as perhaps not so different as an image from the men kneeling in prayer, because if we think about it, perhaps there's, I guess my question is, would it make sense to speak of this as a categorization of individuation, or is perhaps something else happening in these two images?
I think if I understand you correctly, you're saying, well, that poster is very nice, but he's still talking about categories to some extent.
No, I'm just wondering about individuation as a category, because it seems to me that the specificity, the implied specificity, is still in the service of an abstraction, which is going back to the category of Arab, which one can argue is still a somewhat non-individuated category. Mm.
I don't think that the goal was to undermine the category or undermine the existence of the category of Arab in this case. The goal was to create a differentiated view of the category, to enhance the heterogeneity that is perceived within the category. to somewhat approximate the heterogeneity that we perceive within categories to which we belong. All this is to be understood and has been comes out of a long research tradition in which the categories usually refer to as in-group and out-groups, right? In-groups are the groups we belong to, and out-groups, of course, those we do not belong to. And of course, they can vary. In some contexts, you are Arab or Italian or a woman or a professional or of a certain race and so on. It varies from context to context because we can all have multiple identities. Right? But I think that individuation in this sense is to point out, it's a tool. It's a tool to undermine this monolithic view. And I believe, and actually there are facts on this as well.
Facts. We agree with facts. We might not agree about the facts.
But facts are important. We're not that postmodern, right? There is a lot of evidence that these two images produce very different outcomes in terms of the perception of Arabs. You know, the two have not been used in the same experiment, so I cannot claim that. But I would bet a lot of money on this, that the impression and attitudes that people would have after exposure to this image is very different. It's very, very different. And of course, I'm not saying that this is, it's a silver bullet. You know, once we have this poster, we have solved the problem of perception of Arabs in France. Of course not. But it suggests that it's a tool that can be employed and does have an impact on the lives of these people in this high school in which it was tested, in these colleges. So the images are important. It may create other effects that we're not aware of, and to some extent, it's it should be this has not been really investigated, but it does do what it is supposed to do to undermine this entitative, homogeneous perception of the other, which is the base on which then prejudicial attitudes are built and implemented.
Could I say something about that? Even though you didn't ask me, I'm very interested in that question. And here's where my thinking went. What I wonder is when that kind of intervention's made. Here are 12 people, of Arab ethnicity, who live in wherever, Paris, who have these various human strengths and frailties. Whether against the background of that, all the rest of people who become categorized Arabs remain fixed, that's one question. And two, whether, and this is what I thought you were saying, whether what people encounter is not, these are now just individuals, but rather, these are individualized Arabs, and Arab stays fixed. I desegregated a school back in the day. It was before the formal end of Jim Crow. I desegregated a school for 8 years. And believe you me, man, me being there didn't make that much difference to how they thought about anything about black people. I was just there and managed to survive it for 8 years.
Can I bounce on this?
Let's debate.
There's so much research on this, Ruth, in psychology, mm-hmm. about, there's even fancy terms for it, and I think is exactly what happened to you. You were subtyped. Mm-hmm. They probably forgot you were black.
That's what they used to say to me. When I started, I was Negro. I became black during those years.
All right.
It was 60 to 68.
Because they make an exception. Literally, you forget that this, that is a member of that group. But that's why I think that's why I shoot these posters and not results from another 500 experiments in psychology mm-hmm. that show that we're very good. We're very good at subtyping, the exception that confirms the rule. If you present, and in fact, there were many versions of the poster. Posters that presented completely, exclusively positive were not as effective because we have a tendency to subtyping or subgrouping and create it. And in that case, what happens is that you take this group of 10 Arabs and you subtype them, and the image of Arabs as a whole doesn't change, which is exactly what you're afraid of, and I think what you were implying. But that's why, at least this data suggests that if it is done in this way, where you create enough complexity, what is undermined is really the perception of Arab as a whole, not of these 10 individuals, because we would not be interested in this. These are, well, they're real people, but they're not, you know, we're not interested in changing the image of these 10 individuals, which is really the struggle that we're confronted with. I mean, it's social psychologists, the other example of which we were influential in policy was the whole, you know, the famous contact hypothesis and the segregation you talk about comes from that idea that if you put people in contact with each other, somehow they will change their minds about, you know, how unpalatable these people are, right, mm-hmm. after a while. And we know the limits of this, you know, it didn't work out exactly as we thought it would, right? Mm-hmm. But these posters and these attempts, these are attempts to do this in a different way, learning the lessons of, you know, 40 years of research showing that contact per se and presenting, you know, individuals who don't fit the stereotype is clearly not sufficient because we're motivated to. You know, in the 80s, we thought it was just a consequence of cognitive processes. We became a bit smarter and understand there is a strong motivation to maintain these stereotypes for, you know, for cognitive coherence because of it impacts our identity. And of course, you would probably say it creates imbalances, challenges the power structure. So, you know, you can have all motivations at all these levels, and they all conjure up to maintaining these stereotypes unless we find the right tools to undermine them.
Just a thought experiment. Could you have a language that doesn't categorize at all? And I actually think the answer is no. So what you're then doing is different ways that you might make the way what language always necessarily does work or not work differently. But let me, yes, encourage someone from the audience here. No. It's, you got the mic. I'm just waiting for it to come to you. And we got to wrap up in a couple of minutes, right? So, yeah, 5 minutes, okay.
We could think of maybe poetry as a language that categorizes in a different way, but that's beside my point.
Yeah, yeah, but it still categorizes.
I wanted to ask, actually, Ruth Wilson Gilmore, when you were speaking, I thought to myself, my God, Ruth Wilson Gilmore for president.
Yay! I inhaled.
And you probably did. But then I thought, would Ruth Wilson Gilmore want to be president? And do you believe in democracy? And if you believe in democracy, how? I'm curious because it's a panel about post-democracy, mm-hmm. and I think we are looking at... I'm living in Athens right now. It's supposedly mm-hmm. the birthplace of democracy, but of course the Athenian version is a complete slave state, and it's what this country's democracy was based on and how it was rationalized. Mm-hmm. So I also wanted to ask about some of your ideas of how do you navigate the kind of horizon of democracy, because that's very often posed to us in these situations, and if there's some alternatives or how you think about it.
Mm-hmm. That's a great question. Can we stay till 3? It's a great question. One, I don't want to be president. Two, I don't think the United States of America, which has in a certain political science under a certain political science rubric, a stable democracy because the government changes every four years and everything doesn't fall apart. That said, the way in which participation happens in this vast and populous country is highly uneven, as you know, even in the centers of power. For example, as all of you probably do know, Washington, D.C., that district, those people have no franchise to vote for national leaders. Yeah, they're a colony. The District of Columbia is a colony. So, I mean, just to put that, and it's also a predominantly black city. So just to put that forward. I'm extremely skeptical of how enthusiastically people embrace democracy as though it were objectively, no matter how actually enacted, a good thing. And you said Athens, slave society, the stratum of free. United States, slave, and other excluded society, the stratum of free. And the Herrenvolk democracy, and that's the word that I think David Roediger used to describe it, you know, eventually included, but it's also always actively excluding. There's no universal suffrage in this country to this day, truly. So then what is it? I'm going back to my man, Du Bois, my favorite, the great communist sociologist, W.E.B. Du Bois, in his book 1935, Black Reconstruction in America, posited two kinds of democracy, as in the period during Reconstruction, both being fought out and fought over. On the one hand, industrial democracy, which was to say post-slave society, dominated by Wall Street capitalism and also the capital that came out of the old plantations, because a lot of people turned their labor value into money value before the war. They saw it coming. So industrial democracy on the one hand and abolition democracy on the other hand. And what he tried to find when he redid his research into the actual experiences of, and I use his words, Negro workers during Reconstruction, was to see that on the ground, people were participating in building societies, not from scratch, because obviously, although formerly enslaved, they had a moral economy, ways of being, understandings, and so forth, that were either newly developed in the context of chattel slavery in North America or derived from, you know, histories and experiences passed down from across the Atlantic. And they were practicing, again, abolition democracy. And perhaps something called abolition democracy I can embrace. C.L.R. James, every cook can govern. I'm not a very good cook. I'm not going to make a stereotypical joke about you, but I bet you can govern. And I see in various places around the world where I work with people trying to produce the conditions for their own liberation through the production of what, again, I'll call abolition democracy, to make an abolition geography. I see it now in South Africa, where the revolution is heating up again. And we hear a lot about the students and Fees Must Fall. What's happening on the ground is so thick, and it involves everything there. It's happening in a small place outside of Lisbon, a place called Cova de Moura, where descendants of Cabo Verdean immigrants are remaking a hill that the municipality wants to destroy, and so forth. So it's happening at different scales as well. I saw you look at your watch.
I was going to ask Karen one more, or should I wind up? One more question or thought from the audience?
So I'm looking at the title of the panel, which is, I think, Political Organizing in Post-Democracy. And I want to come back to Sylvia Winter and actually, and the question of the human. And Sylvia Winter practices what she calls counter-humanism because the category of the human is so bankrupt. And I'm curious about what you could visualize as political organizing for counter-humanism that does not rely on the discourses of the human or the project of rehumanizing to produce, as you call it, a kind of spontaneous, you know, movement towards solidarity or something. How can we articulate a politics of dignity without relying on the totally broken category of the human?
I don't know. I like the word people. I like the I like words like, you know, nature, including people. There are a lot of words that I like a lot. And I actually think, with all due respect, the Sylvia Winter is not about to give up that word human, but rather to sort of hold it up for constant attention. And what she wants to give up is the concept man, which is not guys, it's man. Yeah? I mean, that's what I think. I just had a big debate with one of my students about this yesterday. The student was all upset because Sylvia Winter, who she, the student, thought was turning her back on all of Enlightenment, everything, said, why does Sylvia Winter hold up the Copernican revolution as all that and then say double consciousness is a revolution on equal par with Copernican revolution? I said, well, maybe for recognition. Maybe so you can think big about decentering. You know, think big, rather than what we have to do is develop an epistemology that has nothing to do with what made us, which is modernity. So
I think big about dissentering is a good place to conclude. I'd like to thank my co-panelists and the audience. And thank you.
Thank you.